Thank you for showing us how the force of water, which can sometimes be very brutal, very uncompromising,
keep forgetting,
can be managed.
Like the manager of forgetting the wars.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Very, very, very true. Very true. But also, there's a different view that you can see on the water. It's the view that water is not only the barrier. For example, in Tbilisi, here we have a river in the middle of the city, which is almost a wall.
It's
just a wall.
Yeah, okay.
Straight across, huge space. If you compare it to Paris, you've seen the map. It's a huge body of water, which is actually being utilized for much, much more functional purpose, much more to create much larger benefit for the people. And this is what I'll be talking about in essence. I'll be talking about our view on the field of floating architecture. I'll be talking about some projects that we've delivered and showing some really photos, not just designs, beautiful renderings of how things can be done. Yeah, we are going to create, apart from the river, the rivers around them, which are completely empty. This is the name. So, yes, the answer is fine. Let's build on water. That's very good. So, how do we actually do it? There are three different approaches for building on water. There are many different approaches, but three which are usually applied. One is, of course, you put some, you know, some dirt and some sand on tile, and we create more like walls, no land. So that's new cleaning. The other one is building on piles. We stick some piles into the land, and then we create stable structure, and that's the rebuild on. And the last one is the floating architecture. So just very fast, one of the most famous examples of reclaiming, there they are. You know, we are creating Palm Island, we are creating the world. What was the problem? Well, we are damaging the environment heavily, not only there, but on the spaces where the actual land is coming from. So you have countries like Vietnam, you have countries like Cambodia banning the export of sand from their lands because of the devastation of the environment. So what's happening? So Singapore is not panicking. They're saying, whoa, we have a growing population, but we actually don't have any land to build on. So what are we going to do now? So that's, yeah. No, Singapore is the example that I'm using because they are actually missing land to build. In Dubai, they don't have an issue in space. As such, they can try to combat the desert, if they can, if they're successful to do so. But it's not. Singapore is a very interesting example because this is one of the rare examples where you don't actually have land. You don't have any land. It's not talking, we are not talking about land in the city center. We're talking about land, period. Any land. No space. The other one is, of course, building on piles. This is a more traditional example, but here is a more modern thing. This is built in 2002 in Switzerland. You know, you can see a number of very strong steel piles driven into the land in order to support a structure that appears to be floating. Problem with that is that, yes, the impact on the environment is medium compared to reclaiming. But on the flip side, the resilience of such structure is also medium, because you're still creating a structure which is very firm, very unflexible, unable to move in the environment. And any significant movement in the environment can actually put the structure in danger. Last but not least, of course, is floating. So floating actually allows us to satisfy many different areas of interest, of public interest. It also allows us to utilize this space, which is usually not utilized, it's completely empty. And also, it gives us a structure which is resilient, which can actually move the environment. In an incoming flood, the floating structure just does what the water does, it rises. When it falls away, it falls. So it actually moves with the environment, providing resilience. It's not trying to combat it, because combating the environment, we learn so many different examples, can be tricky. So let's take a view on some of the projects that already exist. This is sort of a view, probably a 10-year span, of introducing floating architecture. So we can start with a floating psychiatric hospital. I will try not to comment too much on why is it that the floating people from psychiatric hospitals actually were one of the first ones to think that our ideas make any sense. And you know, somebody to do the project, but fine. 10 years after the fact, They are still very happy now.
Still close?
Of course. Of course. Actually, we are preparing to dock them. We usually don't do any marine consultancy because it's just too much of a risk and not competitive, to be honest. But only for our existing projects, we take them on water, we help our clients to do so, because then that allows us to learn. That allows us to take a look at the structure 10 years after the fact and see, you know, okay, this could have been done. Or we've done well, we can come in there and implement this. Another interesting project is this floating restaurant. And I wouldn't be necessarily talking about floating restaurants, but this one is very interesting because the space that we're allowed to actually use is only 6 meters wide. And it's almost 50 meter long structure organized in a 6 meter wide space. So apart from stability, which was a bit of a challenge, the biggest design challenge here was to actually make a functional space. Make a space which you can actually use, which is very narrow and very, very long. And we managed to create a restaurant, quite a popular one, which is holds 250 guests. And actually now we are receiving a repeat order for that restaurant as well, so we are going to be building another one. This is another interesting structure, not maybe because of its use, but for different types of reasons. The first one is that it's created in the very center of Paris. So we introduced a nightclub, a bar, a restaurant, sort of all that in one structure, but something in a place which is located 300 meters from Eiffel Tower. Very central of Paris. You can't get more central than that. And this is, there's something very interesting happening on this photo. I'm not necessarily talking about the fact that, you know, owners are making loads of money with this particular project, so much so that they've actually ordered a new one, which we are going to be delivering in probably 2 months' time. This one holds 700, this one will be enough. So they ordered one that holds 1,000 people. And so they're going to take that one away and bring the new one in. But the interesting thing for me at least is this integration of the floating space and the land space. Because actually the people, the interest of people, because it's located just there in a very attractive space where everyone can visit. And it's not only the tourists that visit, which is extremely interesting, it's the locals. Very often in conversation with locals, you know, they come there because it's just so nice. And this full integration forced the design and eventually implementation of a huge terrace, which was completely integrated and of course agreed with the historical society, to the port of Paris, and all the other regulators which approved the design, but actually allowed the land space to be developed because of it. And it's not only that, the old structure, which is now which I've shown, which is going to be moved to another location, is causing the same effect. So we are building the floating structure, and just because of that very fact, we are developing fully the space of land.
Right.
Yes. So
is it floating and moving, or is it docked and floating?
It's docked and floating. It's not moving. This is not a passenger vessel. Basically, so this also for our agency, it meant also implementing a new, not for us, because we are marine based, but also meant that we now need a competency in land design architecture. Because now we are developing as much on water as we are on land. Quite interesting. Another very interesting project is the Museum of Urban Art. This is also, of course, a floating museum developed on three different levels. Structure-wise, very airy, very light in order to allow the art, modern art. And we are talking about, you know, samples of graffitis, samples of art that looks like Andy Warhol approved it or something like that, all in this particular space, but in any case, in its environment, which is the city in which they were built. And again, this is how the project looks at the moment, not at the moment, I've taken this photo 2 weeks ago, but in a month's time, this is going to be a live and breathing structure, an open project. No, this is a floating exhibition space, a floating museum, if you will. It's going to be alive and breathing. And probably because the company that is actually financing it is going to go viral, it's going to be a very, very famous structure. Last but not least is the floating hotel that we delivered for a company in Paris. And I'm not going to speak about this particular hotel now a lot. I'm going to move forward for some of the projects which are in construction and circle back to that one. Because it's a very interesting piece of architecture. Another interesting project that we are going to actually start to cut steel in a month's time is a floating gliding center. So yes, that
floating and
yes, basically. So my reaction when I started talking to an investor, and he said, "Oh, I want to do that." My reaction was, "Oh, are you sure?" And of course he was sure. He was completely right. He was completely wrong, because what he developed actually with our help is space design every square inch of it, designed specifically for his particular need and to deliver this specific product for his customers. He managed to move that space into the very center of the city, and he managed to, by creating it, get the approval to utilize the land space around it to create even bigger, even larger, even more exciting things for his customers. And that's really the beautiful thing about it. And because we are talking about very developed, very, very popular area, which is city center area, when you compare the cost, we are not talking about largely exaggerated cost because he moved to floating architecture. If he couldn't have built something like this in central Paris, there's no space. So if he wanted to go into existing structure, he would need to be compromised and never deliver the same level of service. Another very interesting project is the floating sports activity center. This one is interesting because it has a floating swimming pool, Olympic size swimming pool integrated into that space. Part of that, it has a restaurant, it has a gym, it has many different areas included. And we see two different illustrations here. The one on top is the one in the summer, where a huge terrace is going to be allocated onto the land. But since the land side is a flood area, sand covers that area in the winter, the requirement was to be able to move all the elements of that terrace onto the floating structure during the winter without impacting the capacity. So the floating structure actually can accommodate 1,500 people. It is 150 meters long, 15 meters wide. So significant number of people, and the capacity remains unchanged during the winter.
15 meters wide.
15. We have a huge. It's not about. It can be 15 meters wide. It's
about the river.
Exactly. But that's the limitation, and that's exactly what I'm. Thank you for the introduction. That we're going to talk about now, because coming back to the floating hotel, which is sort of a paradigm for introducing a floating architecture in the center of the city, is the development of these big structures despite all the limitations, which is the width of the center, for example. So just give you some feel about the dimension. We're talking about 75 meters long, we're talking about 15 meters wide, 18 meters wide, we're talking about the pool again, the terrace, we're talking about 54 rooms and 4 suites, we are talking about the restaurant for 80 people and the use of some nice material which needs a place to look natural as much as can look natural, with steel and glass, and comfortable. The limitations that I was mentioning are several. The biggest one is the height limitation, which is only 6 meters, because we can't pass many bridges if you're higher than 6 meters. Another one is that no shipyard in Paris can actually build a hull that's long 75 meters long. No, that they don't have the capacity, so you have to go out of Paris. And the fact that you can't really sail the 18-meter wide structure to Paris because the locks, river locks, allow it to be only 11.4 meters wide. So what we need to do is build two buildings, two hulls, and we decided to do that in the end, which is located in La Manche, or depending which side of the land you actually stand, the British Channel for some, and told them to Rouen, which is a port facility which allows us to actually do the implementation of the last meeting, and then finally deliver to Paris. But as finalized units, because remember in the very center of Paris, you can't really close down the center and say, oh, okay, I'm going to do something for 3 months here and, you know, just be patient.
Float.
Yeah.
The locks are passable?
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. Only 11.4 meters wide.
That's the width.
Yeah, that's the width. You can't be wider than that.
But 15 meters?
18. I'll come to that. So two hulls. As you can see them coming out of the shell in the end. Loaded one on top of the other in order to move faster and be cheaper in transport.
Yeah,
Then delivered, then told over to Rouen. Simple tolling arrangement, one load, no complications there. In Rouen, we basically pre-fabricated all the modular units. So we can see the accommodation unit being lifted off the truck and straight into the hub. And this is how we constructed the entire hotel, with this basic principle, everything pre-fabricated. And after that, two separate buildings were towed to Paris, where they were collected, connected to shore, and then one to another. So in this particular example, we created two buildings together, connected them with a road, which is sort of a metaphor for Paris, with its life, left and right bank. We also delivered a building which has a very minimal environmental impact. And the reason for that is that we are connecting only to the river wall, it's not like a river sir, only to the river wall, and basically hiding the connection with the bridge, which you need anyhow for access. And last but not least, we created a very resilient structure, which operates even in the highest of floods. When some of the piers are actually closed in Paris, this hotel operates no problem there. So this is a general management view. I will just run through it very fast. On the left-hand side below, you have a small marina, which in flood is very useful because the water taxis come in, take the passengers and leave, so hotel can operate even in high flood. You have the kitchen and all the other technical functional areas, and moving to the right, you have accommodation units. On top, you have the bar and the restaurant, you have the pool, you have the reception in the back, and moving to the right, and then you have the rest of the accommodation units. This is a cross-sectional, so remember the height, only 6 meters. So we needed to accommodate functional living space into that height, which this type of structure allowed us to do. You can see that there are two completely separate hulls, two completely separate buildings connected together and moving together in the river without any safety concerns. And you can see the street in the middle, the functional, almost public space created in the middle for those two structures to coexist. This is how the hotel was going to be from the outside now. This is the view from the bar. This is the bar, restaurant, and pool in the beautiful Paris night. And this is the central space. So carpeted space, completely open, opening windows. So people actually meditate there, do yoga there, come for a chat there. It's an amazing public space that's created in the middle of these two floating buildings. And this is just a standard accommodation that we have. So this is what exists. So these are all photos, these are not renderings and beautiful drawings, this is what's done. So basically, when we are deciding to take a step forward and think about the future and what the future is going to be, we always have discussions see that growth in both scale and scope, because obviously population, number of people is rising, number of available space in the city centers is obviously decreasing and there's no space. And last but not least is the resilience. The weather conditions are changing, and there's a lot of bad things happening with big structures which are close to the water, as we had an unfortunate example here as well. So one of these proposals, one of these solutions, one of these designs is the Moor. The Moor is a multifunctional floating facility created for life and water. It, as all the other floating infrastructure, it has this ability to have minimal impact on the environment because so it obviously floats. And it's very resilient because it moves in waves and dives in the streams. And last but not least, this is a very sufficient large structure. If utilized as a hotel, it can hold up to 100 rooms. Important thing to mention is that the solution is perfectly scalable. So as you can see out there at the bottom, you can move from one triangle of the Moor to four triangles more. When in the case of a hotel, that would be more than 400 rooms. So just a quick view of the general arrangement of the building, not to go into details, but just to emphasize one very important point. Even this single section of the Moor is designed as modules, designed in three basic modules. You have the pool in the middle, on the left and the right, you have the main sections, and in the back, you have a circle section. And the reason for that is that it allows the Moor to become almost a Trojan horse, a structure that you can move easily and almost overnight put together and deliver it in the very center of any urban area, but not only the urban area, in some remote areas as well.
It acts like a vessel.
It acts like a vessel, completely acts like a vessel. This is a view from within. The main purpose of this illustration is just to understand that this is a structure built on three different levels, which can accommodate from different activities. We have designs for the theater, we have designs for the opera house, we have designs for office blocks, we have designs for commercial center, we have designs for different implementations of this particular structure. And this is just one of the views on the accommodation unit, which would be, of course, modern, smart, very, very nice and spacious. Very important thing, well, important thing for us, and I think important thing for our clients, is that these approaches are following and are drawing heavily into our previous experience, into all the studies of the structures, studies of the mooring arrangements, studies of the land, studies of the behavioral moments in the water, which actually allow us to be perfectly confident that these types of structures can actually work. And elements of this particular structure are all already tested in all of our previous projects. Mm-hmm. So that's a beautiful thing about it, because it's not only the idea that we are presenting here, we are presenting the experience as well. Just a minute. This is a very, very interesting, in essence, concept changer. Because here's a tender project that we are participating in a moment for a city of Bologna. And what these guys are actually doing, city planners, they're saying, okay, we have this fairly large area of 400 kilometers long, and we want to redevelop it. But we don't want to create a ghetto, we don't want to create a single structure, it's going to be a restaurant, and then that's it. We want to create a neighborhood, we want to create a community. We want it to be completely integrated with the land in this structure and structures that are all around there, in order to create a block, a living block. Is that fine? All right. And that's a very interesting example, because it allows us to actually take a step back and say, okay, it's not about a single unit with a special function, and that's it.
And what are we doing?
Yes. It's about actually planning first, then designing, and hopefully one day delivering a community, a floating community. And by doing so, we can actually almost seamlessly introduce all these romantic notions and benefits of living in water, and connect them with all the practical, smart solutions of modern day living, just by taking that step back. And as I said, by planning, by designing, and finally delivering structures which can actually support this idea of full integration between floating and fixed. So with that thought in mind, I will thank you for your attention, and I will ask you to join the conversation. Join us with your ideas, with your views, with your possible integrations. Thank you again.